is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show co-host. We have an awesome episode for you today. As we all know, COVID-19 has literally hit the worldwide community. And one of the things we've learned through navigating the challenges of COVID-19 is that the people that were most adversely affected by the virus were those that had compromised immune systems. So I want to do a very special episode with my returning guest, Dr.Uche Odiatu. You'll recognize his name if you're a regular listener to the Thriving Dentist Show. And we're going to talk about things that you can do to improve your immune system and strengthen your immune system so that in the future, if there's any issues with the virus returning or any other lurking virus out there, you'll be positioning yourself to be as strong as you possibly can in terms of your own personal health. Uchi's going to share some really cool, actionable information that you can use to immediately work on strengthening your immune system. Hey, before we get to that interview, though, a couple announcements. You may be familiar with the fact that on Friday, May 16th, we are doing a one-day Thriving Dentist MBA live workshop, live stream workshop. This is Saturday, May 16th. It is 8 hours of content, all done via live stream. And this is set up as a workshop format. This will be the second time that we've done it in a live stream format. And we had so much success with the first one, we decided to offer it again. And it's May 16th. What I do in that workshop is go through the 10 elements of a thriving practice, go through each one of those elements. And we truly run it as a workshop, even though it's live stream, it's virtual. But we do it as a workshop. So there's all kinds of exercises. And the exercises that are in the workshop are all about how you take the information that you learn and apply it to your practice. And in some ways, the live stream format is even better than actual live workshop because you can be in the comfort of your home, you could be in your office, you could be on your favorite recliner, you could be at the kitchen table, dressed in your most comfortable clothes, access to your favorite foods and snacks, and you didn't have to go through travel or the hassles and expense of travel to experience that. Just go to thrivingdentist.com and you'll see information to register for that one-day Thriving Dentist MBA, Saturday, May 16th. Second announcement that I have is you'll also see information on Thriving Dentist about the fact that we have launched a virtual personalized coaching and practice management support. We're offering that to 20 dental offices, to 20 dentists. And it was my response for wanting to help a very specific group of doctors not only just come back from COVID-19, but come back stronger than ever. And I want to invite you to be part of that. We're limiting it to 20 doctors. It's all done virtually. We've got some very attractive pricing on that. So if you're interested in personalized coaching from me and practice management support from myself and my team, I invite you to take a look at that. You'll see information on thrivingdentist.com. Now, on to that interview with Uche Odiatu about how we can strengthen our immune systems. Well, as I mentioned in the intro, we have a returning guest on the Thriving Dentist Show, Dr. Uche Odiatu. Hey, Uche, how are you?
Hey, how's it going, Gary? It's always a pleasure talking. I love sharing with your listeners. They're tenacious, they're passionate, they're curious. Love it.
Well, and as you know, as I reached out to you for this interview, I believe this is very timely, this interview. Of course, your information is timely 365 days of the year. I mean, what's not to like about health and wellness, right?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
But it's particularly timely now. And of course, we have listeners in 184 countries now, and we've all around the world, you know, have been affected one way or another by COVID-19. And while there's a lot of things that we don't know about the virus, we do know some things, and hopefully our learning base will expand. But there are some things we know. And we know that the people that have been most adversely affected by the virus have been those that have compromised immune systems. And conversely, there is some emerging data that shows that a strong immune system is helpful when confronted with a virus. So I thought it'd be awesome to have you back on the podcast and talk about some things our listeners can do to strengthen their immune system, not only now, but literally have it be a habit that they carry through throughout their lives. And while I think, you know, I treasure your information because I use it every day, but I think we may have extra ears on this particular episode because it's never been, our health has never been more front and center than now. What do you think?
Yeah, no, I agree. It's, you need an immune system for everything. For athletes, you need a strong immune system to withstand the stresses of normal work life. You need a strong immune system, but obviously during any kind of pandemic onslaught, you need to have the strongest immune system possible to survive, or if you get it, to have a really short disease exposure. So it makes sense to me. So yeah, shoot, I'm going to bare my soul here.
Well, and certainly there's multiple facets of your immune system, and some of it might be genetics, but there's also a lot of things we can do to strengthen our immune system. Would you agree with that statement?
No, it's easy. Genetics are part of it. And like Dr. Oz says, you know, genetics loads your gun, lifestyle pulls the trigger. So lifestyle is a major impact. You know, the number one cause of death worldwide is heart disease. And Harvard Public School Health said 90% of heart disease is lifestyle related. So this is all lifestyle. But I think obviously there's an economic side, like selling lifestyle is inexpensive. Prevention's cheap, right? Mm-hmm. And a lot of companies and economies make their money off fixing by non-lifestyle related fixes. So I don't blame them. Like they want to push their products and it makes sense to me. But there's no harm in stacking the deck in your favor. And you can definitely stack in the deck in your favor by doing a number of things, which I'm going to share in this show.
You know, you and I both believe, you know, in the healthcare model that we're starting to see on the medical side, we're starting to see a group of physicians that are moving their practice toward helping their patients stay healthy rather than fixing something that's broken. Mm-hmm. And while I believe, you know, you're in outside of Toronto and I'm here in Scottsdale, Arizona, so we've got two countries represented here, but I think you're starting to see that in Canada as well. And it's not mainstream yet. It's sort of just beginning to get some momentum, but we're seeing here, you know, the era of physicians that are more interested in helping their patients stay healthy rather than fixing them when they're broken. And are you starting to see a little bit of that in Canada?
It depends on the provider's background. Like they don't teach a whole lot of prevention in medical school. It's definitely on the repair end, which is nothing wrong with that. You need good mechanics, you need good repairers. However, the prevention people are almost the chiropractors, the naturopaths, the nutritionists, the physiotherapists, dentists who do tons of, can you think of how much, sure, dentists do a lot of treatment, but you know, they say almost half a dental practice's production comes from hygiene, which is completely prevention. Mm-hmm. So if the medical system is not doing it per se in the classic standard, there's lots of complementary medicine that's taking up the slack. And sure, there's medical doctors coming on board because it must be more satisfying for prevention. And I know that if I was pulling teeth all day and doing big decay and endos and crowns, and something to be said about having someone come in and not have anything wrong.
Disease and decay. I mean, certainly it's part of our everyday routine, but nice to mix it up a little bit, huh?
Yeah, I feel it. And it all depends what your thing is. Like some people are, as I said, I did a course one time for some cardiologists and cardiovascular surgeons, and they said they're great at fixing what's broken. But if you ask them, what's a completely balanced diet, like how much fiber you need, how many grams of this, how many grams of that, that's not their area. And so they said they stay current on being the best technical surgeons possible. So how would you stay current on being the most technical world-class surgeon and at the same time being at the top of your game for nutrition? The two don't go together. So you really have to look at which angle you want and which ones resonates strongest with your heart and your mind and then go with that, you know? Mm-hmm. So that's how I feel. So whatever resonates with someone's career or fulfillment level, go with it. And you choose which side to coin you want to be on, you know.
One of the things I've always loved about your tips is how practical they are and actually how easy they are to implement in our lives. I'll never forget one of the early times when we met, and you taught me the Sonicare stretch. And, you know, in live events, I think you've probably trained, you know, tens of thousands of dental professionals, the Sonicare stretch. And, you know, I love the symbolism around that, because in 2 minutes, you know, the same time that you're brushing your teeth with your Sonicare, you can get some great benefits from stretching. And, you know, that simple, tip headed me down a path of learning a lot more about stretching and the benefits of stretching, and I feel like I've reaped the benefits of that you started me. You were the domino that started that.
Oh my God!
And it extended into really learning a lot more about stretching. I spent a lot of time in my runs, you know, pre-run stretching and post-run stretching. And I'm going to give you full credit for that. And it all started with the 2 minute Sonicare stretch.
Wow. That's amazing. You know, it's funny, this whole, I think anytime, you know, we can use our relationships to make ourselves stronger. I think that whole idea of been there, done that, bought the t-shirt is so tired. And I think any master is also a student. So you've mastered so many levels, but you keep having a student spirit. I'm a master in some areas, but I have a student spirit. If I see a magazine, I look at a Dr. Oz magazine on the shelves in a drugstore, I'll open it up, look at it, read it through. I'm looking for the newest stuff. I think all masters want to stay current. So the only way you can stay current is to have an open mind. You know, so here you are, this national level endurance runner, and you take a piece of new information and you improve your craft. So I think a dentist is the same way. We're excellent at what we do. We're refined. We're specialists in an area. We take 30 hours of CE every year. And I think patients love having their masters be lifelong learners. It's a beautiful thing.
Well, I know we've got our listeners' keen interest in strengthening the immune system. Let's dive in and share some tips that any of our listeners can do and they can implement in their life to strengthen their immune system.
Well, I want to start off with the strongest one. I think most people they come up to me after lecture and say, "Uche, what's the best probiotic I can have?" Or they'll come up and say, "What's the best, herb or spice?" You know, I heard raw turmeric is an anti-inflammatory and cooked turmeric is a DNA protectant. And I'll say, okay, it's all good and said and done. I said, "How's your stress level?" "Oh, no, I just want to know about, which herb is best." And I'm like, "Well, did you realize how you manage stress trumps everything?" And they go, "What do you mean?" So if they talk about a stomach issue or a reflux issue or a irritable bowel problem or a bloating problem or a chronic pain issue, at the brunt of it is always some stress that's not managed well. It's pretty rare you get someone who has complete balance in their spiritual, family, and work life and has chronic pain. Like, chronic pain comes up when there's an imbalance. It's the body's way of saying there's something wrong. So if someone has a GI problem or if someone has a joint that's not getting better, there's some chronic stress going on. So no one likes to talk about it because stress is not a tangible thing to measure and fix.
Well, but how timely could this be? Because it's safe to say that many people in the world right now are having challenges with stress management, and maybe many of our listeners. Fair enough, right?
Yeah, for sure. So the American Journal of Lifestyle Medicine, and this is interesting. So they've come out and said that in their articles, in their journal, that anytime we're stressed out or upset, so it's not just angry, it's anxious, frustrated, resentful, feeling helpless. Mm. What happens is our NK cells, our natural killer cells, which are a specialized cell in the white blood cell system. The NK cells take the immunoglobulins that have already taken the virus or bacteria. And what they do is they take them out of the body. So the NK cells get immobilized, which means they get stuck along the vessel wall. And what happens is viruses and bacteria then run rampant. So a huge part of having a strong natural killer system is to have your managing stress somehow. So that goes into deep breathing and maybe prayer, maybe goes into stretching. Mm-hmm. But it's amazing how many of us don't realize that looking at stress levels and managing stress is a huge part to play in having a strong immune system. It's impossible to have a strong immune system and to be upset for extended periods of time. Like, that's always when the canker sore, the ulcer comes up. It's during that time.
What a great point. Yeah, I'm thinking back in my own life, you know, at different stages when you're under stress, and that's when you tend to experience some health issues, and that's when the, you know, your immune system is under attack.
Well, that's where the canker sore. Like, I haven't had a student come in during exam time. Whenever a student, you know, someone in their late teens, early 20s, comes in with a cold sore, aphthous ulcer, it's always exam time. Or so, and they seem like they think I'm a genius. They always think. I said, "Oh, how many exams do you have?" And they look at me as if like, "Are you following me around?" I'm like, "Well, you don't get this unless there's some stress going on." And it's not a bad thing, I said. To be alive means that stress. Oh, yeah, you're right. I have two exams tomorrow. I'm not sleeping well. You know what? Rinse, swallow. Here's some topical, et cetera, et cetera. It will go away after the exams are over. And we get reminded that over and over again. I know that for myself right now, because I'm sitting a lot and doing articles and even webinars. And again, I want to do them more standing. But there's a certain part of my trapezius that gets a little knot in it when I'm intensely talking about something, even that I love. So there's something to be said about... you know, follow my own advice. At the same time, though, that knot only comes out, not when I'm relaxed. It comes out when I'm intensely speaking about something in particular. So the body tells us, they said when we're stressed out or upset or angry, what happens is we get muscle tension. Muscle tension over time chokes organs and it chokes the blood supply to an area. So that's why what's great about you being an exerciser and dentists and the dental team who are physically fit, regular exercise decreases muscular tension. So that's why people who exercise regularly have less muscular tension and have less physiological manifestations of stress in their lives. So physically active people, which is only 8% of the population, don't manifest stress physically and emotionally like people who are physically inactive. But again, 92% of the population is physically inactive. Yeah. And that's why we're seeing the rampant rise of all kinds of manifestations of out of control, anxiety, helplessness, resentment, anger. It's not a bad thing, but if you need to picket and protest, but right. Picketing, protesting is not a mild mannered, gentle activity. All hands on deck, all 600 muscles are on deck, all 100 billion neurons are activated. And in chronic activation, the body pays a price. Constant sympathetic nervous system activation, the body pays a price. And what it does is sabotages you because it steals energy away from digestion. It steals energy away from the immune system. And it puts all hands on deck for the fight. And for some people, if it never ends, they end up exhausted.
Right.
So I know there's a lot said in that last few minutes, but when you understand that, you realize if you are under emotional siege, definitely go outside for a walk. Definitely take some moments to deep breathe. Definitely take some moments to look at some pictures on your phone that bring you joy and not your stock market portfolio, you know?
Well, and, you know, when I think back to pre-virus times, the excuse that many people give for not being physically active is they don't have time. Now, that for many of us, that excuse has kind of gone out the window, at least right now as we're recording
yes.
this, right?
Yes.
And yet, I know that, you know, many people have committed themselves to a fitness routine, an active routine. It could be just walking. Many have done that, but others still are kind of on the sidelines. But one of the things that you've shared with me is that while I do, my general form of fitness is long form cardio, long runs. You've also taught me the benefits of high intensity interval training, which really takes away that excuse of I don't have time because it can be done in 10 minutes. Doesn't require an hour. You know, it can be done in less time. And I know I have really appreciated what you've taught me about high intensity interval training and the science behind it. And it's such a great way to incorporate activity, even when time is, not as abundant as we're having now.
Yeah, I think, again, people intuitively know moving more makes sense. I think I see a lot of people saying, I'm going for a run. You try and buy gym equipment online, you can't buy a dumbbell in North America. You can't buy a TRX. You can't buy resistance bands. You can't buy anything home gym equipment. So I think, you know, 390 million North Americans or worldwide have known that work exercising is important. So it's definitely intuitive. I think even a dog, we used to have a dog many years ago, and the dog, when he got upset, he'd sense he's upset. And what it would do immediately would walk and it would shake out its fur and the collar would shake and you hear the tag shake. So Many people after a big cry will go, we'll take a deep diaphragmic breath. So intuitively we move when we're upset, but some people don't know enough to move. To give you an example, I went to Alcatraz at ADA as part of, it was in San Francisco. So went across to Alcatraz. Guess what they do prisoners to keep them calm every day? They make them go outside for 30 minutes and exercise. So if they want prisoners in an incarcerated, very, polarized, pressurized containment of men and women in a prison penal system, they know that minimum they need 30 minutes, not just of exercise, 30 minutes outside to calm the spirit. So if you want to calm prison population, the penal system, they may not know the science of calming people down, but I'm sure they do. I bet you they've been told. Mm-hmm. If you don't let people get outside and exercise, that negative energy will discharge inside. So I think that's why I started off first with overactive nervous system activation, because it's such, I'd say it's foundational for a strong immune system, is to move, breathe, get outside, get some fresh air, get the lymph flowing, and decrease the muscular, whole science is, it says it decreases muscular tension.
My wife, many of our listeners will know, and you know, Uti, that Therese is a yoga instructor, and she's taught me a lot about breathing and some breath work and breath practices. Talk about breathing and talk about maybe some things we can do that are simple, but can really help us in terms of not only stress management, but strengthen the immune system when it comes to our breathing.
Okay. Well, the number one human need, if you look at the most valuable thing on the planet, if you ask any dentist what's the most valuable thing, they'll mention their team, their family, maybe their car. Okay. Maybe their, few people say breath.
Air.
But oxygen, air, is the number one human need ever. You can live without water for 5 days. You can live without food for 30 days. If you had to retire suddenly, we could live without our practices. If the team went on strike and left us, you could live without them for a while, but you can't live more than 45 seconds without oxygen. So breath trumps everything. So some people breathe better than others. So just to give an idea, so mouth breathing, which now dentists are studying, lots of dentists now are studying mouth breathing, hygienists, myofunctional hygienists are looking at how patients breathe. And if someone has a long face, short mid-face, narrow mid-face, sinuses that are deviated, or if they have chronic mucus in their sinuses from constantly eating foods that aren't good for them, what happens is their mouth stays open to breathe. Anytime the mouth is breathing, the body's getting anxiety, sympathetic nervous system activation messages. There's an orthodontist named Stuart Luce in Georgia, who was one of my hosts at Hinneman 11 years ago. And he had written tons of articles on how mouth breathing not only increases cortisol, which is a demolition hormone, it basically sabotages health, because DHEA, which is a precursor to all hormones in the body, when you're stressed out and your body's making cortisol, all your DHA goes towards making cortisol. And then you have less DHA to make testosterone, growth hormone, and estrogen. You have less DHA to make building and maintenance hormones. All the energy of the DHA goes towards cortisol. And which basically, that's why people under stress long enough look horrible. They look and feel horrible, because the body's not rebuilding in the long term, because all it wants is the short-term cortisol replenishing. So breath is the first energy. Our breath is basically, we're a slave to our breath. And if someone's breathing shallow, or breathing in through their mouth, which is inefficient, or sitting down, which is very inefficient. As I just stood up now to do the rest of this interview. I know you have to sit because you've got all your gear there. But sitting all day basically sabotages your breathing. So people who sit all day, they'll always have more life force energy than people who stand when they walk. And that's why a lot of people do standing desks, or they do standing treadmill, or they stand. If you're having a powerful phone call, many people automatically stand up and pace automatically. So intuitively know when we're standing and walking and breathing, we come across a lot more powerful.
Oh, I love that. And, it's interesting. I think you've probably bumped into her in on the lecture circuit, Trish O'Hare, hygienist, and we were together a couple years ago on a Smiles at Sea cruise.
Oh,
and she and I were the only ones in the gym in the morning at 5 a.m. You know, the gym on the ship.
Yeah,
we were the only ones there at 5 in the morning. I guess everyone else was at the chocolate bar, you know, or, yes. or coming in from the nightclub or wherever.
But yes. Yes.
We'd be at the gym at 5 a.m. And that first morning, she came into the gym and grabbed the treadmill next to mine. And you know, we said good morning. And, you know, I started on my run on the treadmill and she started on her workout. And after a couple of minutes, she said, hey, Gary, I know that you're not a mouth breather, but I'm noticing that when you stress yourself, you know, and you're pushing yourself on your run on the treadmill, that you start to breathe through your mouth. Do you realize that? I said, well, I've really never given it thought, but you're not a mouth breather by under normal conditions. But she said, you know, you're not getting the most efficient use of the oxygen. And she said, would you like to break that habit? And I said, absolutely. As I know enough about science to know that if I'm breathing through my mouth, I'm not getting the efficiency, you know, breathe through my nose, I'm getting much more efficient oxygen. And she kind of had me at hello when she said, if I can teach you to break your mouth breathing habit when you're under duress running, you'll get 18% more oxygen. I said, okay. And so we stopped the treadmill. She reached down into her gym bag and she pulls out a tape, you know, the kind of tape that you would put on a dressing, you know, on a wound, you know, to tape, maybe a dressing. And she said, this is going to look like crazy because you're going to look like the hostage runner, but is it okay if I tape your mouth shut? And I said, you bet. There's only two of us in there. I didn't care. And so she tapes my mouth shut. So I had to breathe through my nose. And we did that the whole 7 days on the cruise. And she said, continue it another 3 days once you get back home. And she said, you know, use the tape and you'll break the habit of it. And next thing you know, you'll be you know, you breathe through your nose under stress when you're really pushing yourself with running. And so another tip that has paid off handsomely in my training.
Yeah. And that whole mouth breathing thing is huge. I've heard Trish speak in 3 hours. I took like about 20 pages of notes. On top of that, I took home her handout, which she's very generous for. But so simply, you know, many people want, you know, I'll do a webinar and then I'll get this question. What's the best apple to eat? Or I'll get a question. What is the best green tea to buy? And I'm like, it's almost like my friend Peter Berry, he's a practice management coach up in Toronto, says it's called intellectual disease. Most people, as you know, are too smart for their own good and they get stuck on the minutiae. They lose the forest. No idea they're in a forest because they're stuck on what tree is this? So I think sometimes looking at the simple foundational truths is the best way to get better. I think a lot of this, I saw there's a show called Legends. It's on Netflix right now. It's on the NBA, Chicago Bulls in the last season with Michael Jordan and Scottie Pippen. And the coach, the best coaches talk about the fundamentals. They don't talk about the weird drills and, you know, taping one hand behind your back and running, you know, like Rocky did, chasing chickens with his shoelaces tied. It's fundamentals. And I think the best coaches are fundamentals. The best friends that we have do fundamentally things other people don't do. So I think we get stuck sometimes looking for the esoteric, the little fine things to make us different, like proprietary differences. But I think some of the best experts, the top people, it's the principal foundational principles where they go. And breath is such a foundational principle to manage stress and to feel good and strengthen an immune system.
Right. Andrew Weil, who I know you're familiar with, an MD. Andrew Weil is a physician that teaches a nice balance between Eastern medicine and Western medicine. Mm-hmm. Are you familiar with his approach?
Yeah, I've eaten in his kitchen and we went,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah, we were together. We had a great meal together at one of his restaurants here in Scottsdale.
Is it True Kitchen or True Health?
True Kitchen. True Kitchen. True Food. Yeah. True Food Kitchen.
True Food. Okay.
Yeah. And Andrew Weil is a physician down in Tucson, Arizona. And like I said, he has a nice balance between kind of Eastern and Western approach where he's not against, you know, surgery and pharmaceuticals, but he also incorporates a lot of naturopathic methods of healing and health as well. And I really like his approach. But he teaches a method of breathing that he calls the 4-7-8 technique. 4-7-8. Are you familiar with that?
I've heard of box breathing. There's many different kinds, right? But you tell me. I'm curious.
The 4-7-8 technique, it just goes like this. You take in a breath, just breathe in through your nose to a count of four. So as you're breathing, you know, count 1, 2, 3, 4. You now hold it for a count of 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and then breathe out for a count of 8. And so that's a cycle, 4, 7, 8, 4, 7, 8. And you're going to want to do that three or four cycles of doing it. It take, you know, a couple minutes, not even a couple minutes to do that. And one of the things that's happening is it's switching your nervous system over from the sympathetic nervous system, fight or flight, to the parasympathetic nervous system, rest and digest. And it's amazing how effective that breathing practice or that breathing exercise is. And it's just extremely simple. You could do it. You know, I know Tuesday's your long day, right? When you're back to
work. Not in the last 6 weeks. Yeah.
But right, not in the last 6 weeks, but generally.
It's Tuesday. And I may never work 12 hours again. I've enjoyed, I may never do a 12-hour day ever again. You know, like.
But you can do it any day you're practicing. You could simply grab, you know, 2 or 3 minutes and, in a quiet space in your office, do that breathing technique. And you're going to notice your body switch from sympathetic to parasympathetic nervous system. It's amazing. Something as simple as that.
Yeah. And again, I love my dentist friends. I love the hygienist friends. I love the assistants. However, the question I'll get is, what kind of tape do you use for your mouth? I'm like, please. You know, so the minutiae, I think it's, and again, Peter Berry says intellectual disease, but I think, as you said, just bring in more, anytime you make your breath more mindful, immediately sympathetic goes towards parasympathetic. So the minute you even think, because we breathe, most people don't realize, if you ask anyone, ask a smart person, how many times a day you breathe? And people will all estimate, they'll say, what, 4,000 times? No, 12 to 15 times a minute, you do the math, it's 20,000 times a day,
yeah.
20,000. So if someone's breathing inefficiently, you will have pain. You'll have some muscular pain because then little muscles have to overwork to get oxygen to your brain. So a lot of people have a forward head posture and it's not from reading, it's the fact that the head goes forward to get more oxygen into the brain. So if we stood better, our chins would be further back than what we think. So the body will do anything to breathe better. And that's why trapezius get sore, rhomboids get sore, scalene muscles get sore, eyes get sore. It's incredible what we do to our body. And in the name of good, like, you know, we're healthcare providers, we're reading, we're studying, we're doing webinars, but it's amazing how much we abuse our body and sacrifice our health for our long-term goal. And then we spend the last 30 years spending tons of money on chiropractic, acupuncture, just to get our body back. And God gives us the best one off the bat. And we ruin it in the name of, you know, I did it for work. Well, they say a lot of dentists sacrifice their body in the first half of their life, and then they spend hundreds of thousands of dollars to get their health back in the last half.
Yeah. Hey, can I share a fun, amusing story with you about our propensity to kind of chase the silver bullet?
Yes.
So this is a number of years ago, and I was on a wonderful program that included Dr. John Coyce, Dr. Gordon Christensen, and myself. I'd say that's a decent speaker lineup, wouldn't you say? The only one missing was you, Uche.
Thanks, man.
You would have rounded it out. And John was up first. And I don't know if you know John, but I love him. He's an awesome educator, just a supreme human being. I really enjoy Dr. Coyce.
He's Washington State, right? He's an intense guy. He's
yeah.
like...
Yeah, he is.
He's almost like a hitman. His nickname is the hitman, for crying out loud.
Yep.
Like, he's a loving guy, but how could your nickname be the hitman?
Yeah, he's a loving guy, though. And so he was, and it was a big conference, and John was given a wonderful presentation, and he was talking about a very complex restorative case that he did. And he was telling the story, and he was actually telling the story not from a clinical perspective, but from a humanistic perspective. In other words, the way this patient had suffered due to their dental condition. And John was telling a wonderful story about how over time he was able to take this patient through a complex restorative treatment and really change his life. I mean, radically change his life. And Gordon and I were standing in the back of the room, just taking all this in, and it was just wonderful. And Gordon and I were standing shoulder to shoulder, and John probably went on and described this case for what must have been 20 minutes. And it was like you could have heard a pin drop in this room. We could all picture this patient and what they had suffered from through, their dental condition and how now their life was completely changed. And John said, hey, before I get on to the next part of the presentation, any questions? And a dentist raises his hand and he said, what burr did you use on tooth number 7? And Gordon elbowed me and said, he doesn't get it, Gary.
Yeah.
But he wanted to know what burr and, you know, what was the particular, you know, burr number that you used, you know, with your handpiece on tooth number 7. I guess I'd have to translate to the international tooth number system, but yeah. You know, yeah, you're bilingual, you're bilingual, international tooth system and the one crazy US system that only we use. But he, you know, that you're always looking for this. So I guess this doctor thought the silver bullet was the burr that you used, but it was actually the humanistic spirit that Dr. Kois treated this patient in addition to his wonderful clinical care. But I found that to be an interesting story, how sometimes we're trying to chase the silver bullet. Like, hey, just what kind of beef should I get, Uche? What, you know, when I go to the, go to the butcher next time, what kind of beef should I get so I can instantly get to be, you know, great health?
Well, if you watch Gordon Ramsay or some of the top chefs, people get stuck on what spice is that. Look at the passion they put into it. Look at the vigor. Look at the you know, think of Emeril, that New Orleans.
Emeril Lagasse.
A big thing of his thing was bam, bam. It was like his passion he put into the cooking. It wasn't the exact spice or what. Do you use all clad or do you use Crusade? Like, it's the bam. It's the sizzle. I think we forget it's the passion put into it. Like Michael Jordan was a short player, 6'6". They said, yeah. Is he tall enough? And blah, blah, blah. One of the greatest players ever. So we get stuck on the statistics. We get stuck on the minutia. And it's the it'll be told. It's a history. It's a history of man. We get stuck on details and we lose the big picture. And but then again, it's paradoxical because they say the success is in the details, but mm-hmm. not in everything. You know, I the big picture, the common threads, the principles, is for me is where I'm going. That's so. If you look at 10 different nutritionists, and if they do a lecture, they're all trying to make themselves sound so different. Right. And I'm like, could I go at the end? I'm just going to do the common threads and create some clarity and have the audience go home being able to have an agenda rather than being more confused.
Well, this gives us a nice bridge into the topic of nutrition. Talk about the role of nutrition and our immune system.
Okay. Well, after the human need of air, the body wants building blocks. So people don't realize you are what you eat. So if someone doesn't like the way their knees are, look at your diet. If you don't like the way your chin looks, look at your diet. If you don't like the way how much muscle you have, look at your diet. So you are what you eat. So technically, anytime the body is not getting its needs met. So if a builder is using styrofoam, no matter how good of an artisan he is, if he or she is using styrofoam and no nails in their house, it's going to be a sloppy house no matter how good the builder is. Mm-hmm. But if you have the best tools, like the best tools, and you have the best wood and brick and stone and limestone, you can build an amazing house. So anytime the body is not getting its needs met, the body is stressed. So stress comes from many areas. You can have psychic stress, like not having, being helpless, feeling not, like you have anxiety from feeling helpless. Mm-hmm. Your body can have stress and poor breathing. So now most people have two things. And the third thing is, because all the food that went in the first week of this whole disaster, people bought their childhood favorites. They bought all the crunchy stuff, the sweet stuff, mm-hmm. all the comfort foods. And now the body's being starved psychically. The body's being starved oxygen-wise. And now you're starving the body of nutrients. So just eating poor quality food is stressful. People sometimes don't realize eating poor quality food is stressful. And then the body keeps having you crave everything. So you eat a big crappy meal. Right away, half an hour later, do you want something else? Because the body didn't get its needs met. And the minute you give your body the best whole foods possible, your body chills out, calms down, and it goes on to long-term repair.
Mm. You know, I'll get real timely, like up to the minute. At least here in the U.S., and I don't know if that's the case in Canada, but at least here in the U.S., there's some discussion right now about some of our food sources, the supply chain being burdened and being stressed, and we're going to see some shortage of some things coming up, in particular meat and pork and poultry. Some of those plants are being shut down because of kind of microburst outbreaks of coronavirus in the plants. Has that news made it north of the border?
Yeah, we've heard in Alberta there's Cargill, a big company that might have issues. Had a couple people test positive. So
we're starting to hear now in the media that you know there's likely to be a shortage coming up of beef, poultry, and pork. Can you suggest alternative sources of protein? That if that's reality, we can start to look at some alternative sources of protein that's going to help us nutritionally.
Sure, and I'm watching my fair Netflix. I haven't watched Ozarks yet or The Tiger King, but I have watched Game Changers.
Okay.
Again, a little extreme. It was all kind of one-sided, but they were talking about the power of plants. And I think right away people get excited, going, "No, I can't eat all." Don't worry about not eating all vegetables. All you got to do is eat more. And you think, well, how much more? Well, they said 95% of us, 95% of North Americans, out of 390 million people, 370 million people don't eat 5 to 9 servings of fruits and vegetables every day. Mm. So the whole idea is being that that's stressful enough as it is. But I've also heard, though, and I've heard a number of nutritionists say, even athletic nutritionists and performance nutritionists, if you're getting enough calories, you're getting enough protein. So they said there's very few instances of people being admitted to hospital for lack of protein. There's very few people going to dietitians, nutritionists saying they lack protein. So the big thing is protein, protein, protein. Do you realize how little we actually need? The gorilla, the horse, and the cow, which we're eating, all eats plants. So the strongest, most muscular animals all eat plants. You ever had an arm wrestle with a gorilla or tried to bump into a bull? They all eat plants. So even though their digestive systems are slightly different than ours, there's something to be said about the power of vegetables. So not that I still eat meat, but I go for the hormone-free, grass-fed, free-range. Mm-hmm. But in terms of alternative meat proteins, from soybeans to nuts to walnuts to seeds to even broccoli and dark green leafy vegetables, couscous and quinoa, there's many kinds. I'm not really concerned about the meat shortage. It's like, right. You know what? There's more than what we need. And I've saw some stats from Michael Howard, who's a neurophysiologist, and said there's very few true vegans who are overweight because they eat so much plants and whole clean sources. It's very hard to be overweight eating plants. Just try it. It's almost impossible. You get tired chewing before you're going to get your belly grows out.
Right. You named some great protein sources that any of us can incorporate into our nutrition easily. Hey, let's go the other way. And I think you know my wonderful friend from London, James Gulnick. I think you've had the opportunity to bump into him on the lecture circuit. He's a dentist from London. That his campaign right now is to help people eliminate sugar or at least radically reduce sugar, you know, from their diet. Mm-hmm. You know, this is kind of a personal campaign for him he's got a little one, a young daughter that, you know, was being exposed to a lot of sources of sugar kind of as just expected. And he decided to, as a dentist, of course, and you, Uche, as well, and any of our listeners see the ravages of sugar on tooth structure, of course. But talk about the maybe some things we can do to cut down sugar.
I've heard Robert Lustig is a pediatrician in California, and he was speaking at the AOSH meeting last October in Nashville. And I see the point. You know, I see the point. Sugar is not great. And Paul Check, an exercise scientist out of San Diego, mm-hmm. said that many years ago, it's for the last 100 years, they've asked any scientist to come forward with any paper showing that there's nutritional value to sugar. And back 100 years ago, they were going to get $500, which was a lot of money 100 years ago.
Sure.
No one's ever written an article. No one has ever written an article on the nutritional value of sugar because there is none. So, but what it does, though, it's a taste enhancer. It's an antibacterial. If you put it in a food, it won't turn green. You'll never see a French fry being green in a closet. If you lose a Pop-Tart under your car seat and the car is 10 years old and you lost it the night you bought it, and 10 years later, there will not be any green on the Pop-Tart because there's so much sugar. So I realized sugar is good as a shelf life, antibacterial, a taste enhancer. It stimulates more appetite. However, I think to try and say eliminate it completely, it's almost impossible. Mm. Every commercial is about processed. There's very few commercials for apples and broccoli and couscous. It's all processed food because as you add energy and as you make food more complicated, you earn money. So it's hard. An apple sells very inexpensively, but any processed food is more expensive and you can package it more. So I see the economic reasons why sugar is pushed and we'll never get rid of it. But what you can do though, if you focus on giving your body what it needs first, you'll have less appetite for sugar after. If you give your gut flora what it wants first, which is fiber, couscous, whole grains, broccoli, and you say, oh, I'll have my treat later, you'll have less of the ice cream. You'll have less of the dessert. So anytime you give someone what they need, basically the wants change after, if that makes sense. So you give your body top quality food, whole food, the desire for sugar will go down. So fill those kids up with broccoli and red peppers and orange and yellow peppers, fill the body up with fiber first, with blueberries. And all of a sudden, do you want any dessert? Yeah, I'm full. The body shows full messages a lot quicker once we give the body what it wants. But if you're not getting what, if you're all you're eating is diet food and diet this and diet that, and oh, I'll have the diet ice cream. 2 hours later, you're putting on your OJ disguise, going out at night looking for the ice cream, going through the drive-through. So give your body the whole food first, and you'll less likely have, you'll want the junk food after.
You know, you raised a phrase in there that I want you to talk about a little bit as well, and that's the role of the gut and your gut health and your immune system.
Yeah, it's powerful. I think I'll be talking about it in front of, you know, 800 healthcare professionals. And I'm invited to a few different places this year, and I'm excited about it only because it's still this, there's a whole idea of bacteria being bad. And 98% of the bacteria in our bodies, and we have 100 trillion single-celled organisms in our body, are good for us. We live very well by them. If you and I didn't have bacteria in our body, for one thing, mitochondria have bacterial origins. And they said 500 million years ago, mitochondria entered our body and allowed us to make ATP for energy. So we rely on mitochondria, which have bacterial origins, for energy. Also, those 100 trillion cells contribute towards our digestion. They also, 80% of our immune system is in our GI tract. This is said by gastroenterologists Robin Chutkin, Emron Mayer, Julia Enders. So the gut is the major player in the gut is the single-cell organisms. They're not even of human design. There's about 21,000 genes in the human body. The collective genetic footprint of the different bacteria, there's about 2,000 species of bacteria in the body. It's 8 to 10 million genes. So people don't realize, whether you're Dwayne The Rock Johnson or President Trump or you're Jesse Ventura, no matter how strong you are, we are a slave to our bacteria. These single-celled organisms, which don't even have a brain, that's the crazy thing. They have no brain, they have no legs, but they run the show. Because if you're constipated, have diarrhea, bloating, if you've eaten something badly and you have to vomit, Dwayne The Rock Johnson would be on his knees if he had bloody diarrhea from C. difficile. Mm-hmm. And it's simply from microscopic, invisible bacteria. So these gut bacteria with no brain, they don't have a brain, Gary, which is weird. Like you and I have multiple degrees, but we're at the knees of bacteria which don't have a brain. It's embarrassing. So we kind of poo-poo them. But what you do, though, is the minute you give your bacteria what you want, you know what the fundamental need is, and this is from immunologists and microbiologists, Jeff Sonnenberg and Rob Knight. The minute you give your bacteria fiber, which is cheap, the minute women have 25 grams a day, men 35 grams a day, all of a sudden the bacteria shut up. And now they say, you know what, Uche, I'll give you what you want, mental clarity. I'm going to train your immune system through the TREG cells, and I'm going to make you more insulin sensitive, and I'm going to slow down aging. How's that? All for the sake of giving me some broccoli and giving me some whole grain, really good quality bread. So this is wild stuff. And I've done webinars for an hour on this basic subject, but it's mind blowing. It's simply mind blowing. I'm telling you now, I don't realize how mind blowing it is, because it's pretty simple to feel good. But it all starts off with how much fiber you had. And you know how many people actually get the right amount of fiber? It's 3%. Wow. So 3% of people in the Western world get 25 to 35 grams a day. They say on average, most people get 10 grams.
Did I hear you? I want to make sure I heard that correctly. For women, the daily goal would be 25 grams of fiber, and for men, it would be 35.
Right. Depending on your size, obviously, and age. Sure. As you get older, you need a little bit less. But again, when you think about it, only 3% get that much. And you think, is it expensive? Fiber is so cheap. An apple, 4 grams. Avocado, 13 grams. 100 grams of pinto beans, 18 grams.
Wow.
100 grams of almonds, 18 grams.
And with those last two choices, getting some protein in there as well.
Oh, for sure. So the cure is simple. The prevention is simple. But we make it complicated. The next question I'll ask. Can I take Metamucil every day? I'm like, could you focus on the food, for crying out loud? Like, our body recognizes food without ingredients. Like, the minute you put something in your body with an ingredients list, right away the body goes, okay, that's going to take a while to digest. But if you put broccoli in, Ezekiel bread, which is 100% whole grain, sprouted, the minute you have couscous, the minute you have an apple with no ingredients list, the minute you have an avocado with no ingredients list, all of a sudden the body chills out. The minute you give your body what it wants, all of a sudden stomach flattens out, cravings go away, your face gets more youthful, aging slows, and people go like, Uche, what do you do to your face? I eat whole foods and I breathe deep. I exercise, I drink water, but what else? I eat whole foods. But people want the complicated subject. You know, people want the inside minutia. And anyway, I keep talking about the principles, and my desire is to create clarity and help my colleagues and patients. And hygienists get this stuff, though. Hygienists know about prevention.
Yeah.
Hygienists, no prevention. You talk to half my courses, I'd say 80% of my courses are filled with hygienists because they're all about prevention.
Yeah. Well, you've given our listeners so many cool ways to enhance their immune system, which is timely for right now. But also it's timeless because it applies in every day in their life. I know that a lot of our listeners are going to want to stay in touch with you and keep in touch with you. I love your Facebook page, among other channels, social media channels, because you will often post photos of a super healthy, easy breakfast or a super healthy, easy snack. You might post a quick workout, routine. I've seen more than a few photos of you in the gym at the hotel wearing your dress shoes. Because there wasn't room to take the runners.
Carry on, travel light, right? You know that you travel like 130 days a year. So
travel light. How's the best way if our listeners want to keep up with you? How would you say the best way is for them to do that? Should we direct them to a social media channel?
Yeah, I'd say, my Facebook is full. They can follow me, but they can't really friend me. So I basically, believe it or not, I do more on Instagram. Instagram seems to be, well, it's a millennial thing. People under 45 love Instagram, and I think the open sieves, student minds, they're looking for information. So Instagram, it's Fit Speakers. So it's F as in Frank, ITSPEAKERS. So it's Fit Speakers. That's my Instagram. I'm also, if you go to my website, it's DrUche.com. So DrUche.com. And you might have it in the spelling of the title of the show notes today, but I have articles there. I've co-authored articles with a hygienist on gut-friendly chairside conversations, because most dentists and hygienists think they have to get a PhD in nutrition before they start talking. And I'm saying, you read this 3-page article. It's got 17 references. You will have enough information. If you read it, print it out, highlight it, and read it, you'll have enough information to be able to go toe-to-toe with anyone and help any patient for the next 6 months, because it's got 17 references in it. And the latest information on fiber, probiotics, on breath. And I wrote it with a hygienist because I really wanted to get that preventative spirit, because most of us dentists are focused on full mouth rehab. Even though you need good teeth for chewing fiber, hygienists have the time for sharing and talking prevention. So that's why I wrote this article with a hygienist. But that article is available. It's on the homepage.
I'm going to put both those links in the show notes. So the show notes are available at thrivingdentist.com. If you're listening, don't take your hands off the wheel. We advocate safe podcast listening. But when you get back to your desk, go through the show notes, thrivingdentist.com. I'm going to put a link to Uche's Instagram account. I want to really encourage you to follow him there. It's entertaining, educational, fun. It's a blast. And then also put your website, DrUche.com, lots of resources there. Uche, I just want to say thanks, man. We've known each other for many years now, and I just want to thank you for how you've contributed to my life, how you've contributed to my perspective on health and wellness. And I use something that you've taught me literally every day in my life. So I just want to say thanks, man.
Thanks, Gary. It means a lot to me. I think sharing is caring. And I think every time I share, it's a bit of a selfish component, because whenever you share, it goes deeper into my own brain. So the fact that you're acknowledging it, I know you're a master. So, and I always tell people, I might look like a guru, but every master was once a disaster. So at some point I read, I learned, I'm listening to audiobooks all the time. I'm a voracious reader. So I love sharing. I love posting. My Instagram is all referenced. I reference sources. I put book posts, articles, the American College of Sports Medicine. I haven't referenced National Enquirer yet. So it's all neat scientific journals, but I try and make sense of it. And I love it when fellow colleague like yourself says you valued it. So it means a lot to me, Gary, very much.
Well, thanks, Uche. And hey, I want to take a minute and thank our listeners. Here at Thriving Dentist Show, we appreciate each and every one of you. There's three things you can do to support our work. First thing you can do is tell a colleague about it. Hey, you may have some friends, some colleagues that could benefit from strengthening their immune system. Share this with them. Second thing you can do is you can jump on iTunes and write a review. Positive review for us on iTunes works like a positive Google review works for your practice. Third thing you can do is you can hit the subscribe button. You can do that on iTunes. You can do that on Google Play or whatever your podcast directory of choice is. When you do that, that means every Wednesday when we upload a new show, it'll be automatically uploaded for your listening convenience. On that note, let me simply thank you for the privilege of your time and tell you I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.